Brazil, la 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 la, na 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 na, na 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 na, Brazil. As you can tell, I don't know anything about that song except for Brazil. Hi everyone, thank you so much for clicking on this video. And thank you so much to Fernanda Nascimento Orchids and Succulents for recognizing that I do, in fact, own a purpurata, Lelia purpurata, and asking me to join in on this care collab. And yes, here are my three. Thank you very, very much. Apart from Fernanda Nascimento Orchids and Succulents, today as well, Patricia's Orchids, Karin's Orchids, Mary G. Orchids, Plants and Other Things, Tropical Plants Finland, Matt by Nature, and Attainable Green also have this orchid and are in on this care collab. So before I get into why you're looking at the back, which is actually their front, I just want to get out of the way some of the nerdy stuff that I know and what makes these so desirable. John Lindley established the Lelia genus in 1831, and it includes about 25 to 60 species. So unfortunately, I could not find why Lindley decided on the name of Lelia, but it is possible, I'm not sure, but it is possible that he referred to one of the virgins of the Vesta or an ancient Roman noble family. Either way, I find Lelia is a pretty name because there are some really funky ones out there. So Lelia really is, for me, the elegant name that does this orchid and its blooms justice. I find it a shame, because I like the name Lelia so much, that some of them are being reclassified to Cattleyas. We have so many Cattleyas out there. Leave us with some Lelias, please. So they can only be found in South America, Central America, and depending on the species, some of the Lelias will grow as epiphytes and some of them as lithophytes. The reclassification to Cattleya, they are determining that by the number of the pollinia. So the blooms, not so much the growth or anything of the sorts with regards to how it grows, it's the pollinia that they have determined makes it a difference whether it's a Cattleya or Lelia. Endemically, they grow in treetops in the regions of Rio de Janeiro, from São Paulo, Santa Catarina, and Rio Grande do Sul. And no surprises there then, they are the national flower of Brazil. It is such a popular and desired orchid that in South America, there are a variety of collectors and breeders who only deal with this type. Japan has also jumped on the bandwagon, and together with Brazil, there are many exhibitions dedicated exclusively to Lelia purpurata. And another thing is, I mean, this blows my mind regarding Lelia purpurata, and it kind of makes it understandable as to why some people just dedicate themselves to these. There are classifications which are determined according to the color of the sepals and the characteristics of such, the lip color and characteristics, and petals. So when you, for example, see a Lelia purpurata variety Ardessia carnea or Cananduba, that is referring to the sepals. Tipo as well, which is the most commonly one. But when you go to the next classification, the lip, there's another 12 classifications of the lip for Lelia purpurata, which could be anelata, argolao, atro, or aurea, also verkhoiserii, which I happen to have. The classification of the petals only has three: striata, venosa, or flammea. But if you were to go and say, I want to have as many Lelias as possible out of all the classifications, you would total 29. That is petals, sepals, and lip classifications altogether. There's 29. So it's hardly surprising that everybody seems to enjoy them and collects them or breeds them exclusively simply for that fact. I have a link in the description below from Röke Orchideen, which shows you the entire list of the classifications and their names, if you are interested. This brings me to something that I would like to put out there for everybody. I have here Lelia purpurata variety striata. This orchid has not bloomed for me. I have here Lelia purpurata Berghäuserie, variety Berghäuserie, striata. How is that possible? You see, in my head, I'm thinking if I have striata, that's the variety, and if I have a Berghäuserie striata, shouldn't that be a cross of Lelia purpurata variety Berghäuserie crossed with Lelia purpurata variety striata? And that is where I'm thinking, how complex is just this Lelia purpurata genus in its own right, that it is possible that a nursery isn't getting the labeling right. I can't say for 100% whether that makes sense or not, but in my opinion, based on everything I've read up about these guys, that should be Lelia purpurata variety Berghäuserie crossed with Lelia purpurata variety striata. My opinion, I just grow them. I am not an expert. The only thing I can tell you is how I grow them, which I will do shortly. We'll get to that. This is little one here is Lelia purpurata Berghäuserie. And these two have bloomed for me. Straight up striata has not bloomed for me yet. So I am hoping that at some point I will be able to compare the blooms of my striata with my purpurata Berghäuserie striata, because again, the classification goes by petals, sepals, and lip, differentiating the characteristics of the same. So I have the striata here that did bloom for me, and it has the flares in the petals, and it has the Berghäuserie characteristic of that beautiful kind of old lavender, almost into a blue-gray, which matches the lip of my Berghäuserie, which has absolutely no coloring to the petals, but that gorgeous, gorgeous, very stated blue, almost gray kind of a washout lip. And oh my goodness, the fragrance. The fragrance is out of this world, gorgeous. It is strong, but not invasive. It is elegant, but still powerful enough that you can appreciate it without having to get close to the bloom. The Berghäuserie is something that out of the world. It's a lemon sherbet, a rich, creamy lemon sherbet. There's a very citrus note in there, and as you get closer, the waft of a cream hits you. Whereas the variety striata that I also bloom, it is definitely more on the lemon meringue side. It is much more citrusy. It is also intense, but not invasive. It has the more intensity towards the citrus, as opposed to the Berghäuserie, which has a real push of heady cream. It's delicious. It really is delicious. And it is so surprising how they differ so much in their fragrances. So these two, the blooms, follow what the label says. I am really, really interested to see the normal striata variety bloom to determine whether this should be a cross or because it has all the characteristics and hallmarks of the classification. That is why they called it the Berghäuserie striata. That's how fascinating Lelia purpurata can be. Astounding. No wonder that people are just dedicating themselves to this species. In the beginning, I said we're looking at the back, which is the front, but it is the back because of the way the leaves are turning towards the light. I'm trying to train new growths. Here's one, to grow upright and into the pot and not get all lanky and dangly out of the pot. I have my light source coming in from the opposite side. It's coming in right opposite to where the growth is coming out. And for that reason, the leaves are turning towards the light. And mine are extremely yellow because of the amount of light I'm giving them. I am referring to this leaf. This one is yellow, it's still okay. These two in the back here, when they go yellow like this, they're old pseudobulbs, they're dying off. And I can tell that because of how the pseudobulbs are depleting. The energy is going completely into the front of the orchid, and the pseudobulbs, as they age and become unimportant to the health of the orchid, they deplete and the leaves go yellow. But this leaf here is quite yellow in comparison to all the other leaves. That is because of the angle of the sun. The light is coming in from this side. More light, yellower leaves. Now, ideally, the leaves of a purpurata should be very, very light green. It can look a little bit stressful if the orchid goes into a yellowy kind of a tinge, but I am not concerned because as long as I don't get sunburn, like here, this is recent sunburn from having been moved from indoors to outdoors, I'm quite okay with what I see here regarding the colorations of the leaves. And these leaves in the front here, they are not too dark. That is about the right color of leaf on a Lelia purpurata for flowering because they need a lot of light. You can see the same is happening here. Everything is facing towards the light, even though this is the front of the orchid. The leaves do turn to the light source. And again, you can see the yellowy, greeny tinge of the leaves. And that's perfect color that you want to see in your Lelia purpurata. Now, she is already facing into the direction of the sun that I want when and if a new growth decides to develop in the pot. There is some kind of a bulging happening here, but for the time being, this one is too busy with roots. I'm very happy to see them because all of these were cleaned up last year in 2020 in order to get ready for this growing season. They have nice, clean, healthy climate in their pots. So my Werkhäuserie here is also growing roots. This growth grew throughout the winter, continued growing. It was one of those late growers in the summer. We had a very mild fall and it was pushing out another growth. And then you can tell that some of the varieties will actually be able to bloom twice a year if the climate is conducive to being able to completely grow out and mature another growth with a sheath. I do not have anything in this sheath at the moment. Time will tell whether it will bloom, but busy on the root front, very happy to see that. And another nubbin is starting to swell. This is a very happy Lelia purpurata. Great coloring on the leaves, just as it should be. And then we come to this candidate here that has bloomed for me, and that new growth is coming in at exactly the angle that I want it to. It will be bolt upright straight into the pot. Now, their growing habit will normally stay bolt upright if they get enough fertilizer, if they get enough sustenance. I fertilize mine at 300 parts per million every single time I fill that reservoir in the summer. I have no problem with how much that they consume. I see that there is some residue on the leca, but that is not the problem because there's not much. I've known to have more in other pots. These are hungry, and when they start to grow, I would say just throw in the fertilizer, in my case 300 parts per million, every single time I fill the reservoir. I flush through prior to filling the reservoir with plain RO water, just to make sure that there's enough oxygen exchange in the pot and make sure that there is not as much mineral buildup on the surface if I'm miscalculating the amount of fertilizer. This is a big orchid. She needs a lot. And with this growth here, with the temperatures warming up, she will take all of that up as well. The other ones, same thing. I don't change or treat them any different. 300 parts per million throughout across the board. What I do have in the winter is a little bit more restrained fertilizing, especially with this one here. It was growing a new growth throughout the winter, so I can't stop giving it what it needs, but I have to pipe down on the amount because it wasn't growing as fast. Only in the last 2 or 3 weeks did this leaf open up, and you can see the difference in color of the sheath. Suddenly there was more light and it darkened a bit. And you can see where the newer part of the sheath grew and just developed in the last weeks. But in the winter, I will go at 160 parts per million, let's say half of 300, especially if they are in active growth. Now, they do prefer a wet, dry cycle, as many, many Cattleyas or Lelias will prefer. I grow in self-watering and Leca, and you can see that there's no issues at all with this culture. I have an extremely dry climate. I need to be able to compensate the lack of humidity, and this is how I try to go about it, to create a humid enough environment for the roots to grow, and also make sure that I never miss out on giving the orchid what it needs as it is producing new growths. So my summers can get really, really hot and have extremely dry winds, and my winters are a little bit cool, but they can take it. I go down to, well, this last winter, I went down to 14 degrees Celsius in my dining room, and I'm not supplementing with any heat mats. I only supplement with lights for about 10 hours a day in the winter when they're indoors, simply because I don't want the cold nights to take them out because of my setup. They can get lower. They can really do with lower temperatures. It's not a problem, but I have Leca and self-watering, and the evaporative cooling of this setup is something to be mindful of, especially in my case when I'm not supplementing or helping out with any heat mats. And I always have a variable of about 3 degrees, where I think if it's 15 degrees at night outdoors, I'm going with 12 degrees in my pots. That is sort of where I draw the line, simply because I don't want to take the risk. I have space for them indoors. Where I have them on the top shelf of my rack with the blurple lights right above them, I do keep them up there, even though they may not be in active growth, just because that is how they would grow in nature. They're out in the canopy of the trees, they get a lot of light, and I try to do that and provide that as well for them so that they don't stall so much during the winter. But in the summer, they're on my east side shelf. They are behind a curtain. You can see that by the color of the leaves, that curtain is important. You can also see by my sunburn that that curtain is important, despite the fact that they like a lot of light. So there is a little bit more of a protection. The east side is my hottest side, which they also very much enjoy. And if the sun is out and the curtain is down, it is a white curtain, they still get enough light to be able to have that coloring on the leaves. Pest-wise, never had a problem. Thank goodness, I have not had any pests, not even aphids as the buds were developing, no scale, no mealybugs. It's been awesome with these Lelias. Absolutely a breeze for me to grow. I don't have any issues. The big thing is that to make sure that the climate and the health of the pot is conducive to what the roots like, because it is a more wetter environment, but in my climate, there is absolutely no hesitation that these orchids are doing well with this setup, and I can keep up with their needs. So I hope I haven't left anything out. I would like to say thank you once again for remembering that I'm growing Lelia purpuratus. Thank you, Fernanda Nacimiento Orchids and Succulents, for reaching out to me. And to all the other channels, the video links will be in my description if you are interested to see all the other environments, all the other setups, and all the opinions of how the other channels are growing their Lelia purpuratus. Then all the links are in the description of this video. And I encourage you to go have a look-see, because not everybody grows in Leca and self-watering. And maybe this is not the setup that would appeal to you based on your environment. Have a look-see. There's 8 more videos to have a look at and find additional nuggets of information regarding this gorgeous species. Thank you so very, very much for watching my video. I really appreciate it. Have yourself a wonderful day. Hope to see you in the next one, and please take care and stay safe. Bye.